Check, 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 check. 1, 2, 3, 4. Check, check, 1, 2, 3, 4. Check, check, 1, 2, 3, 4. Check, check, 1, 2, 3, 4.
Ladies and gentlemen, I apologize for the delay. It's just going to be about 10 more minutes. One of our speakers was unavoidably detained on the way here. I think everybody here can understand the difficulties of weather and the uncertainties of transportation these days. She will be here in about 10, 15 minutes. In the meantime, please enjoy each other's company and make yourselves comfortable. Thank you.
Well,
Yes. Hi. Hi, Chair.
Oh, you did this.
Do you have a minute to take a picture with Paul?
Thanks. And Victor.
And Victor, too.
Here he is.
Whatever it is, it'll be evidence within a few hours.
I think it's only right.
Let's get going. Yeah, well, it's kind of the case, don't you think? Jim, Frank, let's stand together.
Did you check it before you left?
Oh. No, yeah, so why don't you, Paul, why don't you? Victor, do you want to move over here to balance? I don't know. All right, whatever.
I'm actually going to do this.
Musical chair.
No, we're fine. We're just flagged right with everything.
Just waiting for the microphone to be activated.
Good morning. Thank you for joining us here today. Just want to introduce some of the folks standing up here and sitting up here with us. My name is David Yaske. I chair the New York City Taxi and Limousine Commission. Joined this morning by Paul Tobin, President and CEO of United Spinal, by Edith Prentice, representing the Taxis for All campaign, by Commissioner Victor Calisi of the Mayor's Office for People with Disabilities, by Jim Weissman, who is General Counsel of United Spinal, by Commissioner Frank Carone of the Taxi and Limousine Commission, by Julia Pinover and Sid Walensky of Disability Rights Advocates. Today, we are joining together to announce a landmark settlement of a lawsuit that will lead to a phase-in of wheelchair-accessible taxis up until the point where half of all New York City taxi cabs will be wheelchair-accessible no later than 2020. Over the past 12 years, the Bloomberg administration has made substantial progress in ensuring that passengers in wheelchairs have access to taxi service, but it is not enough. Everyone standing up here and sitting up here together has agreed that it is not enough, that we need to do more. We have not always agreed on exactly what to do and how to do it and how fast to do it, and there's no reason to say otherwise. Of course, that's been true. But today, we join together as New Yorkers and as people who care about the future of the city and the health of the city's taxi industry and its ability to serve all New Yorkers and all visitors to this city. Today, we join together to finally right a flaw in the taxi system, a flaw of decades and decades that has been a blot on a system that we are otherwise enormously proud of. And I will say, just speaking personally, it's been for the past 4 years a source of great pride for me to play a role in stewarding what I believe in my heart is the world's greatest taxi system. But the failure to afford access, real meaningful access, to people in wheelchairs has been a counterpoint to that pride. And today I am thrilled beyond words that we are finally acting to address that flaw. Under this agreement, we will publish, the Taxi Limousine Commission will publish a rule by the end of this year. When adopted, that rule will provide that starting in 2 years or possibly sooner, depending on vehicle availability, we will begin phasing in accessible taxis as existing vehicles retire. One out of every two new taxis to hit the streets, once the phase-in begins, will be wheelchair accessible, and that will continue up until the point that the entire fleet is at least half accessible. That 2 year period is because we want to make sure that there is a vehicle available that is both hybrid and able to be converted for wheelchair accessibility. That's city law. And it's also the way that we balance all of the goals of the city together. I would like now to turn this over to Paul Tobin.
Thank you, Commissioner. What an incredible opportunity this is now for people with disabilities in the city of New York. The opportunity to have low-cost, on-demand travel from point A to point B within our fine city is something that has long been a goal of the United Spinal Association and all people with disabilities. It opens employment opportunities for people with disabilities and the tourism trade within New York City for people with disabilities, so that it presents an incredible economic opportunity for both individuals and for the city. On behalf of United Spinal Association and the paralyzed veterans and individuals that we represent, I can't tell you how appreciative I am to the mayor of the city of New York and the commissioner, Yaski and Commissioner Khaleesi, for making this all possible. We have come an incredible distance from where we were when United Spinal started this fight. We now have accessible buses, and soon we will have an accessible taxi fleet that will allow our members and people with disabilities to be full participants in New York City and everything that it has to offer. Thank you, Commissioner.
Thank you. And now, you know, and if it takes a moment of logistics, so be it. That's the point. You know, we can't always make everything fair, but when you can, and when there's an opportunity to go the extra mile to accommodate everyone, then it's a shame not to do it. And that's what we're doing today. Commissioner Khaleesi.
Hello, everyone. It's actually nice to go after Paul, because actually he was my boss at one time. So thank you, Paul. Thanks for your words. Thank you, everybody. It's such a great day for accessibility. I want to thank Mayor Bloomberg for his support in telling us to get it done. That was integral to the process here. Commissioner Yaski and the TLC team, Mike Cardoza and the Law Department, and the TLC commissioners, and of course the disabled advocates, because there's nothing that's done without you. So thank you for all your support in making this happen as well. It was just a few months ago that we hosted a transportation expo to show the disabled community what accessible features were for them to get around the city. And that was great. And I and the disabled advocates at the time believed that the best way for us to get a yellow accessible taxi would be to use a dispatch system. And it works fairly well, but it doesn't work for everybody. And fast forward to today, and it's extraordinary. 50%, you know, we're getting there. We're gonna get there, and it's gonna happen. And just like the historic case with making buses here in New York City accessible back in the 80s, and Jim Weissman, I think, was all over that. He's like, you're always involved with all the buses and transportation, Jim. Why is that? You know, you're like a superhero, aren't you?
Way to get to work.
Right, because we need the taxes, right? And this agreement today will help set that standard for accessible cabs around the country. And believe me, when New York City does something, people will listen. So we're looking forward to working with other MOPD offices around the country and letting you know how this deal got done. Having people with disabilities at the table is important to city government. And our office, MOPD, has been at the table. We've been working with TLC to make sure this happens, working hard. David Yaski has been very good at getting us there and keeping us there. So that's really important. And, you know, at times we have to force our way in too. Most of all, I want to thank the MOPD staff for working so hard and providing services for 800,000 New Yorkers. It's really important. And many of you know Jason Michelle. And for those who don't, he's our super counsel and my deputy commissioner over there. And I have to say that I'm sad to say that he will be leaving MOPD in January, which is a big loss to our office and to the city. But I know this day is important to him and the late Commissioner Saplin, because they too worked so hard for this day. And a couple of weeks ago, wheelchair accessible cabs went on auction, and they went for $1.3 million. And I was blown away. And at that point, the argument that accessibility costs too much was definitely thrown out the window. It just doesn't matter. There are 90,000 wheelchair users here in New York City, and that's pretty big. And they have money to spend. They want to catch a wheelchair accessible cab. There are friends, there are family, there are colleagues, there are children, and now we could ride. Thank you.
Edith. Nobody's ever accused me of being overly smooth.
First of all, I want to apologize for being late, but three elevators were out in the subway this morning. I think they're going for a record. Southern Manhattan, elevators out. Okay, good morning. I am Edith Prentice. I'm the chair of the Taxis for All campaign, and many other people have been chairs of the Taxis for All campaign. We have a very fluid group. The Taxis for All campaign has been working for accessible taxis in an organized way for the last 17 years. It's an awesome day today. I'm looking forward to the day when accessible taxis will replace inaccessible taxis as the icon, as the vision for the entire world of what a New York City taxi is. I went to the city store the other day looking for toys. It's Christmas shopping. And I found a really great squeeze toy in the shape of a checker. Imagine in 2020, which is also the year we get 100 accessible key stations. Again, thank you, Jim. And the donut hole is closed on Part D. But, you know, that's not that far away anymore. And it's great. And we've got to push the MTA for more stations. But 50% of taxis is going to be a wonderful experience. I'd like to address how we got here very briefly. New York City wheelchair users have focused on accessible transportation for years. Marvin Wasserman recently told me how his late wife, Sandra Schnur, told him in 1980 that she wished she had the freedom to go anywhere at any time. Now, that way preceded accessible buses, that way preceded any accessible taxis, and basically, you either had to have a car or you had to use an ambulette, which was prohibitively expensive. People had come back from the Democratic Convention in 1980 in Boston, remarking upon accessible taxis. Other members of the community had ridden in accessible taxis in London and in other localities. Marvin always spoke about how there were accessible taxis in Costa Rica. And which I always thought, okay, cool. Taxi industry, tourist industry, they go together. Every place but New York City. It's extremely exciting to think that taxi users can look forward to being able to attend weddings, funerals, and other important milestones of our lives, as well as the accessible activities of daily living. Personally, I look forward to no longer having to wheel up and down Broadway in the middle of the night to go to the emergency room after my local buses have stopped running. It's important to honor those who have supported us for years. The number of people are innumerable, but we would like to remember that Council Member Margarita Lopez with Intro 81, and then we had Council Member Oliver Coppell. We have the former Council Member John Liu, now controller. Again, I would like to thank everyone. It is a wonderful day, and hopefully we have them soon. Thank you.
Thank you. I'd now like you to hear from my colleague on the TLC Commission, Frank Carone. Really, I think as much as anyone, Frank has been advocating for accessibility in the taxi fleet, really from the day that he started on the commission, has been telling me we're not doing enough, and it's not right, period. And he was right. And it's been a pleasure and honor to serve with Frank and to continue to serve with him. And please, Frank.
Thank you, Chairman. Chairman Yasky has always been a friend, a leader who listened to advice. We sometimes agree on or disagree on how to get someplace, but we always have an honest debate. And this is one area where our ideas come together. You know, I often get asked by friends and family, you know, why do you do it? Why do you spend so much time volunteering on the Taxi and Limousine Commission? There's so much effort and sometimes unnecessary stress. And you know, I don't have a good answer sometimes. But the truth is, days like today are the reason that we do it. And it makes it all worthwhile, all the many phone calls, emails, briefings, to make a difference like we're doing here makes it all worthwhile and it makes me extremely proud. You know, we all live in New York for a reason. We love its culture, its diversity, its economic opportunity. And this resolution brings that those things open to everyone which were otherwise precluded, especially those in the disabled community. And I'm looking forward to working on the details to implement this and keep moving forward. Thank you.
Thank you. Sid, are you, would you say something? Ready. Yeah.
May it please the court.
I was just going to say, we know well, and we admire Sid's advocacy skills, and so it's going to be a pleasure to get to hear them once more. Okay. I'm Sid Wolinski. I'm the Director of Litigation of Disability Rights Advocates, a nonprofit law firm that worked to negotiate this agreement with me. Where Dan? There we are. Dan Brown is a partner at Shepherd and Mullen, a prominent downtown law firm that co-counseled with us on this case. This is a very historic moment. The agreement that at least 50% of yellow cabs will be accessible to people with disabilities who use wheelchairs in the future is a triumph, not just for people with disabilities, but for all New Yorkers. This is a meaningful moment, and I would like to take the moment, having been on the opposite side of the table for almost 3 years. This lawsuit was filed almost 3 years to the day. David, to personally thank you for being a visionary and for understanding that an accessible taxi cab fleet is good for everybody.
Same here.
Thank you. And Jim, will you also act clean up here?
I will.
Thank you.
I'm Jim Weissman, and like somebody referred to before, I've been involved in the accessible transportation fight since the late 70s. I should tell you first that this was a real lift for the lawyers. This is a brand new development. It hasn't happened before in our country, and it was unimaginable only 6 months ago by most of the people in the city and most of America. So to Sid and Julia, who has laryngitis and is very outspoken but won't be today, thank you very much for all your work. To the commission and the commissioner, of course, thank you. Also, and Dan, of course, to Shepherd and Mullen. But I have a couple of things that you should hear about this that you may not hear, because the left hand in our city rarely talks to the right hand. MTA is spending over $500 million a year on accessoride. Medicaid, the New York State Department of Social Services, and the Health Department spend $200 million a year just in the five boroughs on taking people in wheelchairs to the doctor in privately operated ambulances. The average cost of accessoride is $66. When have you paid $66 for a cab ride? Once in a lifetime, maybe? Twice? You can remember them. That's how rare they are. This will completely change the equation for not only people with disabilities, but taxpayers. It costs $500 million a year to run Metro North Railroad, by the way. So we're talking about a huge amount of money that's going to be in a de facto way, because it hasn't been planned by MTA and it hasn't been planned by the Department of Social Services. At least the TLC was visionary enough to get it, and the mayor's office was visionary enough to get it. But it's going to happen in a de facto way. We're going to save money. And then someone's going to say, hey, this is great, and we're going to figure out a way to sew it all together. But it's terrific that it's happened. When buses were made accessible, Mayor Koch was fighting us. And he was saying it's cheaper to pick up people in limousines than to make buses accessible. And they should all be picked up by accessoride. And even with buses accessible and 81 train stations accessible, we're spending $500 million on accessoride because people live longer than they did. And their expectations of integration and travel and work and recreation have been elevated in the last 30 years, unbelievably, by the access to the business and recreation communities. So it stands to reason that taxis would be accessible. If you look outside, they're iconic. Everybody thinks of the yellow cab as the symbol of New York. And today, we're changing the meaning of taxi. 30 years ago, we changed the meaning of bus. You didn't have to say accessible bus anymore. Bus means accessible bus now. And soon, we'll be saying taxi, meaning accessible taxi. Thanks, everybody, for all your help and all your support.
Thank you. Before we take questions, if there are any, I would like to just mention a few people aren't physically present today. Victor referred already mentioned Matt Saplin, his predecessor as commissioner at MOPD, not a more forceful and persuasive and wise advocate will you find. Papers made much of the mayor's display of emotion yesterday, and I was reminded this morning of Matt's funeral, at which the mayor also teared up, and I think part of that was a recognition of the extraordinary effort that Matt put forward that had not yet borne fruit, but that would someday, and that's the way things work. I also do want to mention Councilmember Oliver Coppell. Has been a very frequent and vocal and also effective advocate, has spoken to me numerous times to get this accomplished, and when not legislatively but this way, I think he deserves a big share of credit. I also want to recognize a couple of state officials, the Attorney General Eric Schneiderman, who has brought a real focus to this issue from his office, and who we will continue to work closely with to make sure that this is implemented in a way that that is appropriate and that fits their vision. And of course, Governor Cuomo, who, when we were in Albany a couple of years ago, on the bill that has brought us the borough taxis and added new medallions, said the city must deal with the disability issue, period. You know, before we're going to move forward in the taxi, on taxi policy, that's got to be part of it. Of course, this will be the disability access plan that we bring forward to the governor, and I trust that they will find it satisfactory. I also just want to mention, or really thank the colleagueship and comradeship of our colleagues in the city's law department, and the corporation council, Michael Cardozo, who represents us in all matters, and it is his role in the law department role to advocate. It's also their role to find solutions to move us forward, as they've done here. And physically present here is Michelle Goldberg-Kahn and her colleague Robin Binder, who have been the TLC's and the city's representatives on this issue. We're happy to take any questions if there are. I was going to acknowledge and thank the Daily News editorial board. But I don't know if that's breaking the fourth wall or whatever, so I appreciate your bringing it forward.
A question. The agreement is very sparse. 3 years from now, when it's implemented, how will it be decided which cabs have to convert to accessible? So, and then when that cab converts to accessible, will that medallion forever be required to be accessible? Or 3 years after that, can that go back to a sedan?
So, as journalists point out, there's in politics is poetry, and then, government is prose. And today is a day for articulating the broad commitment that the city is making to accessibility. Half the fleet, at least, must be wheelchair accessible by 2020. And there is some guidelines in the agreement as to how we get there, but appropriately, the agreement leaves it to the Taxi Limousine Commission, the City of New York, going forward to fill in the details of how to get there. I don't think you would want a court document to say this medallion or that medallion. Regulators working together with the industry, and I should have mentioned that right up front. The job one now is to caucus together with the taxi industry, the medallion owners, and work together to craft the details for how you get there. We all agree today must be accessible. What that means is no less than 50% on the timetable that's laid out in the agreement. The job over the next couple of months is filling in the route to get there.
So you don't have any idea how you
pay? Well, the economics is part of the, is of course part of the equation, and part of what is going to be no doubt considered going forward. I would take note of Commissioner Khaleesi's point. When the city first sold wheelchair accessible medallions 7 years ago, they sold at a one-third discount to the then price of an ordinary medallion. At the auction last month, wheelchair accessible medallions sold at a small discount. Hard to say exactly what the going rate is at this moment for ordinary, but a discount of maybe 5 or 8% compared to ordinary. So what that says to me is, and I think what that says to all of us here, is that economics is not a bar to achieving this goal. I don't want to pretend that the cost is zero. It's a non-zero cost. And now there needs to be a discussion about how that's apportioned. My view in terms of principle is that it should be apportioned fairly within the industry, so among the various fleets, fairly as between fleets and owner-operator medallions. But that's got to be part of the discussion going forward. If anyone has anything to add, if not. Well, I don't want to bog down in spreadsheets here, but the cost of converting a vehicle today runs around $14,000 to $15,000. The average life of a taxi cab is 4.3 years. So, if you want to divide 15 or 14 by 4.3, that yields an annual cost. As times the number of vehicles each year would become the annual cost to the system.
There is a state program as well.
There are right. State tax credits that are available to medallion owners, but
and federal.
And federal. I'm reminded.
We know this.
Again, I think. Look, we're big here on being realistic. The cost is manageable. The cost is not zero. And now that's got to be part of what you discuss as you consider implementation.
If I may add something to that, my partner Julia Pinover, who was silenced by laryngitis today, and who is the lawyer who runs our New York office. have discussed this issue many times, and. I think it's a mistake to focus on the present cost of the difference between an accessible vehicle and an inaccessible vehicle precisely because there are so few of them. And our experience, disability rights advocates has been working with the ADA as an instrument for 20 years, and our experience has been over and over again, whether you're talking about ramps or elevators or other accessibility devices, when you initiate them on a mass production basis, the cost of it drops dramatically. And I have no doubt that's exactly what's going to happen here. That is the farsightedness of the Taxi and Limousine Commission, and this agreement today will create a market. And capitalism will triumph, and you can count on the cost coming down.
And you also have to think that they never had this this ridership before. Now it's a whole new base that they're able to go after that they never had before. Plus some of the incentives of accessor ride that we hope trickle over as well. So there's money to be made in this.
Sir.
Greenberg has obviously become a major piece of the transportation system already.
Already. Well, the state legislature in creating the borough taxi system provided for 20% of those vehicles to be wheelchair accessible. That, I have to say, has been a real particular thrill, but a pretty gratifying part of the rollout of the wheelchairs of the borough taxi system. That we're seeing now every day another two or three wheelchair accessible borough taxis hit the street. There were the number of call ahead, livery and black cars that were wheelchair accessible prior to June, I could count on one hand and have a couple of fingers left over. And now, maybe 70, and every day it's two or three more. So, you know, soon enough, people anywhere in the city who use wheelchairs will be able to call their local car service or a car service company that is reasonably close by and request a wheelchair accessible taxi. You know, they're very, it's a very different industry. The economics of the yellow sector and the economics of the borough taxi sector are quite different. And, you know, this is what I said earlier, that we all care deeply about accessibility. You have to do it in a way that is practical and manageable. I think the 20% number that was set for the borough taxi fleet is not just practical, but because of the fact that those are cars that not just cruise for hails, but also operate by call ahead, that gets us the accessibility that New Yorkers deserve.
Two more.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. What about the Taxi for Tomorrow program? Is that also this, determined how it fits in?
You know, there's a whole separate litigation about that. and if there was, I didn't mean for a kind of a note of weariness to creep in. There's a whole separate litigation. But this is accessibility. That's what we're doing here today. And the agreement is quite clear. Whether the taxi vehicle for New York City is the vehicle that we at the TLC have envisioned and designed for, whether it's a range of vehicles, whatever vehicles are permitted for use or required to be used, half of them are going to be, at least half of them must be wheelchair accessible, period. This is separate.
Yeah. When the borough taxi plan was first proposed, it was proposed to have a central dispatch system as well. Many of us who are advocates want to see that happening, because in my community there are 7 bases that will eventually have accessible vehicles. But what that means is I have to physically have all of those numbers in my phone and call them one after another to see who has a vehicle available. And if I'm in another part of the city, forget it. Yes, it's on the website. I know that. Mm-hmm. But you know what? I'm going to open up my phone. I'm going to pull down the website. I'm going to have to call them. Central Dispatch, since everyone loves it for yellows, we really do feel it should be for the greens as well. Also because it will also create a single basis of statistical analysis for the utilization of such vehicles.
All excellent points. And I was discussing this just the other day with Ronnie Raymond, who's another leader in the Taxis for All movement. And first things first, we want to get the cars out there, get them on the street. My view is that we can then assess, and the city government, the TLC, at that point can assess in a speedy way whether the way the system has rolled out organically provides the service needed, or whether the government needs to intervene more. If it does, of course we should. But I guess what I would say to you, Edith, and have to make sure that it's as easy as possible for the user. We now are in a position to see what that means practically on the ground. It may well mean it may well mean a central dispatch. You know, where this is, as the mayor has said repeatedly, he has committed and is following through to ensure a smooth transition. We will certainly do everything that we need to do to make sure that there's a very smooth transition to the de Blasio administration. I certainly can't, speak for them on any points. I can't speak for them on any points, and that's a question for someone else.
Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Edith. It's a parade. You want a rain
on it? Hey, I didn't say Bloomberg knocked it out of the program. I was, you know.